person from Detroit. He talked constantly. But you would think he was crazy if you just watched him for 5 minutes because he's kind of repeating himself. Mm-hmm. But out weeks and months, you see that he's just taking and he's slowly turning the idea. And the ongoing conversation, what does this say? What are we communicating? Mm-hmm. Is this mural telling us what, saying what we want to say? And it was always like that. One thing he used to always say is, you know, every part is either adding to it or distraction.
Yes, yes.
And then when I look back, can I take that out? Or can I add it on? Or, so that's, you know, always, there's a million decisions. any piece of artwork, it's like, what to keep, what to take out, what to add,
Do you find like the next generation has enough mentors? Because I think about an artist from your generation, a lot of the artists from your generation had mentors.
Yeah.
And people they could really work with, talk with, share. And I guess I'm missing that in the younger generation. I don't see their work or their conversations. Yeah. Or listen to them.
I think it was invaluable for me. It's kind of hard. I mean, it seemed like the landscape's changed so quickly and so rapidly. I mean, because when, like I was talking about going to school as an illustrator, and they had one little room that was like the graphics computers. And now I've heard it's a whole floor.
Yeah.
So things have really changed so much in the graphic design. You know, you used to have the press type and all that. That's what things are way gone. Sometimes the landscape has changed, but I think the mentor program process is something that's ancient, and I hope it continues.
Well, have you participated in any artist critique groups?
No. No.
Because, how long have you been in that group? I've been in an artist critique group, I'd say at least 20 years.
Yeah.
And there are a lot of young people who come to these groups. So you have the different age groups learning from each other.
That's a great
idea. But
I think in New York they were harder for the space. The spaces that used to have those have disappeared because of real estate.
Well, this really takes place as a in the adult school. It's it's offered as one of the things you can sign up for the adult school. It just so happened that this woman who runs it, she has a following, and some people have been with her almost 30 years. So,
It's kind of interesting because I was just in a meeting today with the National Conference of Arts, and they were saying we need to somehow engage those portfolio reviews and group critique sort of things. Because most people don't have that. They don't have that. It's really invaluable. It's like we're talking about, it's a way to develop that voice in your head.
One of the things we have in the gallery in Maplewood, we have an internship program that we got a grant for, and we actually bring in the students who are in advanced placement art classes to work as interns, and they're paid $10 an hour. And they film some of the artists when we needed videotape, so they are in communication with artists. And this is while they're in high school.
Yeah. Wow. That's what Lockhart used to tell me back in like in the Renaissance, the apprentice would pay the master.
It is traditionally still does. If you wanted to be a tailor in Nigeria, you were an apprentice, you pay for the apprenticeship. So I mean, we've switched it in this part of the world.
Yeah.
But traditionally, other societies, because you're learning a skill, so you pay the teacher. You know.
Yeah.
So.
I have a question. You were talking about earlier this difficulty of working a career and being an artist, right? So do you find? I find that when I'm working, yes, it is difficult. But there's this interesting intensity and desperation that happens because you're working when you're an artist, because it's like you have to make sure that you keep doing this thing. And that's all you're able to think about outside of your job because you have your job and your checks are coming in. I think a lot of artists tend to downplay the the need for stability in terms of creation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it does allow you to pay for your studio space, to buy more materials.
Well, not just your studio space, to just be able to get around, or just be able to get your lunch every 2 weeks from Walmart. It's just your guarantee. So, and I learned this from teachers. That's part of the reason why I went to get my degree. And I was like, you know, I need to have a career. I need to fund myself. I need to, like, stop having all these things. Did you feel that in any sense? Like, yeah, I'm tired and I can't produce as much, but I know that I have a place to go and stability so that I can think about how I
want to
do what I
want to
do.
Yeah, I mean, a child, you know, there's certain things that you can't. She has to eat. I mean, as simple as that. I thought it was interesting also that Beard said that artists shouldn't teach. They shouldn't teach art because they release some of that creative energy in teaching, and then they don't feel like they have to come into a studio. I didn't really feel that, but I can see how that happens to a lot of people. Artists slash teachers say, I don't have time for my own work. I'm exhausted. And not only physically, but creatively. You get exhausted. Because it's a creatively draining profession. It's not like a mechanical sort of thing. Because you're dealing with personalities and creative approaches to getting something done.
It's a stick man on a blanket with an umbrella. He was on the beach. That was the first thing my father said I ever did. And a drawing of a VW Beetle. So that was the start of my, I guess, creative endeavors. And as I was growing up, whatever I was interested in, that's what I was drawing. So if I was into cars, I was drawing cars. If I was into comic books and superheroes, it was that. When I hit puberty, I was doing women. So I got into the mixed media collage, I think, because of the things that were going on around me. My older brother, who's deceased now, used to have his bedroom set up where he had posters all over the wall. And I think that was my first exposure to mixed media collage, him having all those posters on the wall. So you fast forward to when I got to high school, I kind of fell into the whole mixed media collage thing, not really knowing that I'd be doing it today. And so I'm going to go around the room and talk about the paintings, and each one will tell a different story. So this right here is me trying to get away from doing the lines. So I'm really into magazines like Ebony and Jet, and it's kind of bittersweet that Ebony magazine is no more. And most of the advertisements in here are from Ebony magazine. And so whenever I approach these collages, I usually go into it not knowing exactly what's going to happen. And I think this is stemmed from my growing up in the 80s and being a connoisseur of music and MTV. And remember when they used to do the videos and if they're talking about, like, say, love, but you look at the video and it's a bunch of images flashing before you, and it's just to keep you looking at the video. In a sense, that's what happens with me with the collage. I start to collect images and elements, not knowing exactly what I'm gonna do with it, but knowing that it's gonna end up in a painting. So when I start the painting, I think I started with this face here, thinking I was gonna do a portrait, and then it just went someplace else. And actually with this one, if you start seeing lines, there's like a circle here, it's coming around. And so I started doing a painting that was actually based on my father's sketches. These like figure eights or the infinity symbol. And then as I started doing it, what ended up happening was I said, oh, it's starting to look like the usual stuff I do. So then I started trying to break that down and do something different and cover up what I did. Then what happened was whatever I started after trying to cover up stuff, I just kept not liking it. So what ended up happening, this took about maybe 6 months to do. And I started saying, oh, there's a pattern here. If I paint something and then try to cover it up, something's happening. Then I'll cover it up, let it sit for a while, then go back to it and start something totally new. And I kept doing that. And that's how this thing started or ended up. And so I guess the most consistent thing in this painting is the drips, the color, and the advertisements from the Ebony magazine. And so this was a new direction. Then you come over here to this. This is maybe one of the last mixed media collages I've done in this style.